Good morning, everybody. Would you stand on your feet? Come on, clap your hands. Now, if you understand that you're clapping your hands for the glory of God, you would do better than that. Come on, give him your best praise. Come on, shout.
Father, today we remove the chains of slavery from our necks. We are no longer slaves. Lord, we thank you for your freedom, Lord. We thank you that you alone have set us free. Let us dance and sing this morning, for our God is the King. Flow in this place as we enter into your presence through worship. Let your peace fill our hearts and minds as you prepare our hearts, Lord, for your word today. And I pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Look at somebody and say, good morning. It's good to see you. Oh, that's a little dry. Say, good morning. It's good to see you. Come on, Ismael, I see you. I'm ready. Come on, let's praise the Lord. Somebody say, the Lord is great. Come on, let me see those hands.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
feet this morning and praise Him. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, hallelujah, our God. Our God is in control, steadfast, unmovable. Hey, nothing's impossible, 'cause our God reigns forever. Hey. We praise you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God reigns. No matter what it looks like, it doesn't matter how you feel. Hallelujah. 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 Anybody love the Lord? Let me see you. Come on, push it up. The Bible says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto myself. Come on, just say it with me. Say, Father, break out. Say, Spirit, break out. Put it up. But if you're still, God can't move. Come on, break out. Sing louder. Oh, let this place erupt with praise. The sound. It'll turn your situation around. The sound of praise. Spirit, break out.
anybody abandon the old ways? I've abandoned everything I've ever known.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. As you go back to your seat, just tell somebody, I belong to God. Whoa. I belong. I belong. Lord. I belong. I belong.
Jasmine, come here, sweetheart. My honey, come here, baby. Stand right here next to me. Of course, I know everybody knows my wife, Nancy, amen? Amen. Jasmine, Pastor Tobias' wife. For a long time, I've always understood the concept about waiting on God. I've also understood the concept that nothing's given, you got to work for it. Amen? Nothing is given to you, you got to work. Even our salvation, though, was given to Jesus, paid the price. It's a price you got to pay. And even a position in this church, or a title in this church, or ministry, you got to earn it. And he said, how do you earn it? By God calling you and you doing it without even expecting nothing from it. Amen. And I try to do my best that before I put anybody in position in ministry, even my wife, who I love very much, that they have a calling from God. And not to have a calling, but that they know it. That they start tapping into things in the supernatural, the things in heaven that they normally wouldn't tap into until they start walking in the calling that God has given them. And I've seen that in my wife, and I've seen that in Jasmine. I've been seeing it in other people like my daughter Mercy, which I'm going to start a new trend in this ministry called Junior Ministers. Amen. And my girl here real soon is going to be one of the first ones brought in as a junior minister in this church. Amen. And we're going to implement that. We're going to move on that. And we'll get our junior ministers ready to go because they have a calling in their life. They are working in ministry. And they're doing a work of God. Amen. And the Lord put that in my heart this morning on the way to church. Jesus was preaching at 12 years old. He was in the synagogues with the big dogs, having them on their toes. People crowding around him trying to hear what thus says the Lord from a 12-year-old boy. Amen. And you see that through Samuel as well. You see that through the whole Bible of young men, young girls being used by God. Amen. In a tremendous way. And it was counted upon them righteousness. Amen. That they were worthy to be placed in this book for a reason. That they paid that price. It reminds me of the young boy, I believe it was in England, back in the early 1600s, where people were not allowed to read the Bible on their own. They said you couldn't understand it. But there was this one minister of the gospel who started coming against the Protestant church of the time and telling them and telling the people that they could come to God without the priest. They could come to the Lord without this. That the Bible says that he made a way out for you. He said that the veil was ripped in two, and he started preaching this. They came against him, told him to stop. He goes, I can't stop the truth. So they came to arrest him. And on the day that they arrested him, his 12, 13-year-old son was standing there. And they said, if you're going to arrest my dad, you're going to arrest me too. And his dad told him to be quiet. He said, no, Dad, I will not be quiet. I serve the same God you serve. And I believe in the same God you believe. And if you're willing to pay the price, so am I. He goes, I believe in Jesus Christ. And I believe we have access to God on our own. If we just believe and pray. And so they arrested the young boy too. And they took him to prison in the dungeon. And there they pinned him against the wall. They nailed this little 12-year-old boy's hands to the brick wall. And his dad. And they told his dad, if you renounce your teachings and your faith, he goes, we'll let your boy go. Because the dad was going to die regardless. They made up their mind they're going to destroy him. And his dad was about to renounce the teachings and the faith that he believes in. His little boy cries out. He says, don't do it, Dad. He's just like you're willing to die for Christ. He says, so am I. And so the dad didn't say the word, and they tortured the young boy at 12 years old till he breathed his last breath on that wall, nailed to the wall. And then his dad followed and died afterwards. We're talking about a 12-year-old boy. And we're talking about a grown man. What's the difference? There isn't. It's faith. When you believe in God, you open your mouth and you speak the oracles of God, you speak the things of God, the greatness of God. Why? Because it's who you are now. You have faith in God. And I've been watching Jasmine, and I've been watching my wife in the last couple of months. And Jasmine was pregnant at the time with a beautiful baby, and she really couldn't do much, right, baby girl? And so she needed her time to have her baby and then her rest time and then have the baby get to a certain age and where she could start moving. And the moment she was able to start moving around, she hasn't stopped. I watch her running up and down here getting with Nancy, and then I asked her to preach. She gave me that look like, what? Amen. And she preached a message that, how many was blessed that day, that message she preached, amen? When I saw that message, and in fact, next Sunday, she'll be ministering again next Sunday here. She'll be preaching here at church next Sunday. Invite a friend, let everybody know. Amen. She'll be ministering here. I've been asking the Lord for some leaders. Me and Tobias have been holding this up for since the beginning, since he started. And it becomes, you know, it's a big burden, and we need help and stuff like that. So I've been praying the Lord, and I've been seeking. And the Lord says, don't seek too far, but in your own house. Because no one's going to have the vision like those in your house. So I've asked Johnny to start opening in prayer. Right, Dad, Mama? Did she open in prayer today? All right. Amen. I was outside. I didn't get to see it. I opened in prayer, and also she's going to start taking my place in between worship and praise and sharing a word with God. So start developing people who love God, who want to serve God, and want to move forward in God. Amen. But today I want to honor two women in this church. Not just honor them, but I want to introduce to you and pray and anoint them in ministry as associated pastors today. Amen. After today, Jasmine would be known as Pastor Jasmine, and my wife would be known as Pastor Nancy. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. Give God some praise. They're one of you. They're one of you. Amen. This is an honor and a privilege as a pastor to do this. And you know, when I look at my wife, and you know, she's always had a calling in her life, but I've seen her lately move among the women and even among the men here and the youth here and the children and in a way that she's loved and respected, and she is doing a work that I can't stop her. She comes home, she's moving, she's calling, she's doing it. Matter of fact, today right after church, the women have a meeting, all parents, women, right, the women only, for the praise and worship for the kids that are going to be a part of that worship for Easter. Need to stay after church for about 10, 15 minutes and get with your pastor, Nancy. Amen. We can officially start calling her pastor and Jasmine pastor. They didn't know I was going to do this today. They did not know. But like I said, even though Nancy is my wife, God's got to call her. I don't have the power to call her. And then I got to see what they're doing, to see if God's calling them, to see if God's doing something. I see other people like Becky, and Manuela's been working hard out here, and she has, you know, and other people in the church are just giving of their hearts and giving of their time and just serving, serving and serving. Amen. My brother Ronnie, he's, ever since he stepped in this church, he hasn't stopped. He's now the, you know, saying that my brother Tommy's back there. He could come. Sometimes he's worked. Sometimes he has. He's odds and ends, but he's been helping Ronnie and teaching these boys and doing a lot. We thank you, Tom, Brother Tom. And, I don't see his wife here today, so it's the weather, I bet you, right? Yeah, his wife loves this ministry. He loves this leadership. She loves this church. And they've been coming here, amen? And it's so good to have you here. But there's people who work, you know, that I see my brother Reggie, every Sunday faithful. Last week he was in here, had an emergency with one of his boys that had to go to the hospital. You know, then I see him bring at least 5 or 6 young people every week. And you know, I've been seeing a change in them. Really? Change. Amen. Then we got a young man here today for the first time who come from Reggie. Amen. Good to have you, son, here today. And the boys, without hesitation, said, he's always carrying a Bible. I said, really? Well, let's see what the Lord has for him. Amen? Carrying a Bible. Now I need my glasses. Not there. Yeah. No, I thought this was something else. Thank you. So with this, I already put anointing oil in my hands. Will you stand with me and honor this as I present to them and I anoint them and I present them to the Lord. Raise your hands toward heaven. Father God, when we are called for a purpose, Lord, sometimes we don't understand it and we don't know why. But something inside us, our hearts, Father God, just beats heavier, louder. Our soul, Lord, cries, Abba, Father. And this passion and the desire, Lord, to do a work becomes overwhelming inside us that we cannot but do what you ask us to do. And when these things are notable, Father God, and they are seen among your people and among the leaderships, Lord God, and they have to be recognized. So right now, Father God, the power you've given me as pastor over this church And as the witnesses that are here today, Lord, witnessing this challenge of faith, I pray over them and I anoint them as associated pastors of One Voice Praise and Worship Center to do a work that comes from heaven, to do a work, Father God, of healing, restoring, lifting, developing and building and discipling, Father God, your men and women and children in this house. To represent, Father God, the leadership in One Voice Praise and Worship Center, Lord. To always keep in mind that their calling is above this church. It reaches all the way to the throne room of God. And may they always take it seriously, Lord God. And with it, may all the gifts follow it. I anoint them and I pass over the gifts, Father God, of ministry, of pastoralship into their lives, Father God. Every gift, Father God, every armor they need, Lord, to attack the enemy in prayer, in decisiveness, Father God, in critical moments in their life, Father God. May they always be an example, Lord, to come hell and high water. There will always be a praise on their lips. There will always be worship, Father God, and their hands will always be surrendered up to you. And I bless them and I anoint them. And I give them that title here, Lord, an associated pastor. In Jesus' holy name. And the whole church says, amen. Amen. Now come stand in front. Come over here and stand in front of the church. Now I'm going to ask everyone to leave your seats and come and celebrate and welcome your new pastors to One Voice Praise and Worship Center. Hallelujah. Let's move them line to your right. I'm sorry. You guys listen to your ushers. Follow their lead. Hallelujah. Praise your holy name, God. As they do that, sing that song, We Belong.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I belong. Hallelujah.
I've been captured by a love I can't explain.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Now you have me, and I'm forever changed. Now I've abandoned everything I've ever known. I surrender.
speechless right now. I just want to, God, I think we have the most amazing pastors. God is good. God is good. I just want to say, you know, thank you for celebrating with us, for believing in us. One thing I ask, pray for Pastor Bobby, pray for Pastor Nancy, for Pastor Tobias, for Brother Ronnie, everybody. We need to pray. We're going to need your prayers. We just need each other, and we can't do this alone, just like Pastor Bobby said. And I just give God all the glory, all the honor. I'm speechless, but at the same time, I'm ready.
Amen. Yes, I know you are.
I'm ready. You have my word. You have my husband's word. You know him. You've seen us. And just know, I will do all I have to do for God's kingdom. Thank you.
Praise God. Well, I'm excited. I'm excited, and just, you know, I know a lot of women have already addressed me as pastor. I guess they've been calling it. I mean, they're not like I'm Sister Nancy. No, but praise God. And I'm ready, as Jasmine says, to come together, band together, get united and connected, and just be there for one another. And God's going to equip us as a church to go forth. And Jesus, I love each and every one of you guys. Feel free. Anybody can come to me and talk to me, and I will pray with you and cry with you, whatever it takes. But we're moving on in Jesus' name.
Lord, open up the heaven. Let everybody believe. Let everybody see you, and then they'll know. Then this thing's over, and they'll know you're real, and then it'll be the end of it. And with that alone, we'll defeat the enemy. Then we can all go to heaven, and no one go to hell. So we can all go to heaven. No one else could suffer anymore. He goes, Lord, why can't you just reveal heaven to us and just take us home? I've thought about these things a lot of times like that. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Amen? He says, Lord, why do I got to go through this? I believe in you. Just take me home. You know, take us home. Let the rapture happen. Just whatever you're going to do, do it. Can't stand it at any moment now. Bing, we're gone. What if I'm not ready? What if that day I messed up? What if that moment a thought came in my mind that was not right and I miss it? You know, what if I go to sleep angry at night and then you come in the middle of the night and because I'm angry or bitter or frustrated, I don't go to heaven? And what if this and what if that? And but when you're in church or the Spirit of God is moving in your life, and it's at that moment you're saying, Lord, come now. I'm ready right now, right now, because you feel the presence of God. And because we think that's what it is, to be ready. So I want to go to heaven. Heaven is home. I said, heaven is home. So when, as I think about home, as heaven being home, because there's going to be a table there, and we're going to eat with the Lord, we're going to be with the Lord, we're going to be a big family in the Lord, and I'm going to read some scriptures to you that concerning all that, but as I start thinking about heaven, he goes, why? And then the Spirit of God started talking to me. He goes, because if you just give somebody something, it doesn't mean nothing to them. You give somebody $20. Oh, thank you. Doesn't mean nothing. Oh, he's cool. He gave me $20. But if you worked and you get $20, now it means something. I've earned this. This is mine. It wasn't given to me. I did something to receive this $20. I accomplished something to receive $20. something on behalf of my accomplishment. But every time something is given to you, you don't take care of it. But if you work for it, and then you get it, then you take care of it. I've heard many times young people and their parents, when they work, they get a job and they buy something, and the parent takes it away. You can't take it away from me. I worked for this with my money. I went to work and I paid my, this is mine. You have no control over what's mine. And they come to find out that they differ with your opinion. Especially if you're in their house and you're 16 years old, 17 years old. And he goes, well, I bought the car. And so what? You're still in my house and they take the keys away from you. And you're going, I don't understand this. I paid for this. You didn't pay for it. And now you're fighting for something. But you don't fight for that as much as you fought for something they've given you. Because you earned it. Because you went and you worked for it. See, I believe that heaven's the same way. I believe when it comes to going home, like our house, the house doesn't make it a home. It's the inhabitants in the house makes it a home. You know what I'm saying, Becky? In a home, there's got to be peace. In home, there's got to be love. Home is the one place you could go to and know that you are safe. Home is the one place you go to and know that you're not going to be hurt. Home is the one place you could go that you're surrounded by walls and protected from the outside, that no rain or sun or whatever may happen or people, they can't come in your house and affect you. Home is a sanctuary. Everybody say sanctuary. It's a sanctuary. It's a place of safe haven. It's a place that you go in there and you can sit down and relax and know that no one could come in through that door unless you allow them to. And if they do, they're not your friend, they're not your buddy, they're not your pal, and you got to introduce them to Smith & Wesson. Pastor Bobby, what? They break into your house, they ain't breaking in to give you a celebration or a birthday cake. You got to either that or pick up a broom or pick up something. But in your home, it's a sanctuary. Heaven's got to be like that for you too. But God just can't give it to you. He can't say, just here it is, and there you go. I believe that's a problem that a lot of believers have, a lot of believers have, is that we think we deserve it when we haven't worked for it. We think it's our right. The Bible calls it a gift from God. But that gift came with a price. Me and Pastor Tobias have been invited to a men's camp on May 25th. As many men could go, we're going to take them to that camp. It's on Thursday night, Friday night, and we finish Saturday afternoon. I will be the guest speaker at the camp, and Brother Tobias will be leading in praise and worship at the camp. And God gave me a word already. Born a man for godly purpose. When we're talking about Barabbas. But the thing about it is this, that as I was thinking about heaven, this was not the message today. I forgot my notes on my desk at home. And so when I sat there and to try to retrieve my notes, the Lord says, "Spitz, I don't want you to do that. I want you to do this." I said, okay. And so when we think about heaven, when I think about heaven, you know, a wonderful place in the book of Revelations that talks about golden streets, about 12 floors, and every floor is built with a different type of stone, from rubies, diamonds, emeralds, all kinds of different stones. And as you go into heaven, there's a gate that's formed out of one solid pearl. One pearl. You know, the little pearls that we're... No, this is one humongous... That's one big oyster. One solid pearl. And the gate, entrance of the gate is made out of one solid pearl. And the Bible talks about it. And also in other places of the Word of God, it says there'll be no more sun there because God will be the light there. And so many things happening, and we're going to go ahead and go to Isaiah 25, verse 8 and 9. It says here that he will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. Not only that, and the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off all the earth. For what? The Lord hath spoken it. He's going to wipe away all your tears. And not only your tears, but every filth that you've been carrying. Telling me that when we go to heaven, we're not going up there perfect. We're not going up there clean. I remember that song in Spanish says, Me lavo las manitas con agua y jabón. Se las presento a Cristo con una oración. Mucho cuidadito, mira dónde vas. Oí la voz de Cristo, me puse oración. He says, I wash my hands with soap and water. He says, I present them to the Lord with a prayer. Be very careful what you do and say. And who are you with? I have to be trying to translate it here. Because I heard the word of God and I started to pray. We learned this in summer with vacation Bible school. And we'll sing there and we'll act like we're washing our hands, presenting them to the Lord. But also told that nothing unclean will come to heaven. Nothing filthy, nothing dirty, nothing reproach will go to heaven. But here we see the Lord saying, and that the rebuke of his people, the one thing that will keep you from heaven, the one thing that will keep you from going home, the one thing that will keep you from entering in, he said he will take it away. Telling us, Jacob, we're going to heaven not because of a right, but because of a choice we made. We chose his forgiveness. We chose his righteousness. We chose to follow him, and that is the ingredient of salvation. That is how you get saved. For all those who call upon the name of the Lord, what? Shall be saved. Then we go to Luke chapter 13, verse 29 to 33. It says, and they shall come from the east and from the west and from the north and as from the south and shall sit down where? In the kingdom of God. And behold, there are last which shall be first, and they that are first shall be what? Last. Now you need to think about that. You're trying to get the head of the line when you should be in back of the line. Because those on back of the line are going to go in first. And why is that? Because you're not seeking your own. You're seeking the things of God. You're not trying to be the best, to have the most best position. You're not trying, you're not doing what you're doing to become an associated pastor or evangelist or worship leader. All you're doing is serving. All you're doing is doing your bare minimum. And there's nothing wrong with that because this is our minimal service, is to serve the house of God, is to serve the people of God, is to serve the world. Jesus says, I didn't come to be served, but to what? To serve. Saying, I am the least among you, but yet I sit in the greatest honor. You're not seeking your own. When you come home as a father and as a husband and my house, the house is not for me more than it is for my wife and my children. As a father, everything we do is to provide for our family the best we can, Jacob. I'm not aspired to live like the Joneses. What I have is what I have, and what's there with it. And, goes, and you know what? And it's mine. I've worked for it, but I give it all to God. Use this place as you want, Lord. do with me and my family as you want. That's why Joshua said, choose you this day whom you're going to serve, for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. He said, all I have because of you, Father God. All I've done is because of you. You give me the strength. I wake up this morning because you allowed me to wake up this morning. See, when you start to understand that your home is a responsibility, that your home is there to create in you a spirit of understanding. A home is there for you so you could understand God's heart. Jacob, you're not a dad or a husband just because, but you're there because God wants you to understand how he feels about his people, about his children. Becky's not a mom just because she's a mom or wife, but God wants her to understand what it is to care for his children, to know how he feels when they are sick, how he feels when they rebel, how he feels when we act the same way as our children act with us. And so the home on earth is more like, you could say, it's a practice. It's an understanding. It's a school of understanding. So when you look at your home, God says you are the high priest of your home. So if I'm the high priest of my home and Jesus is the high priest in heaven over me, you know, so whatever as the high priest of my home I let in my house, that will dictate what my house is going to be. Dictate. If I allow garbage in my house, then my house will be full of what? Garbage. So as parents, as the head of our house, and everyone here, believe it or not, you're going to have your own place. My daughter Faithy is not coming home this summer after she graduates. Because she has a job, and when she gets out of college, she's got to go full-time in her job. And so she's going to get an apartment with a friend of hers in Tulsa, Oklahoma. So now she's going to have to pay her own rent, pay her own electricity, pay all her bills. And of course, remember that, Mike, when we got our own place? Yeah, we're excited. Remember, did you, when we got our first place? Ah, it was great until the bills started coming in. The bills started coming in, and you're going, oh, my God. See, I made X and Y, and I'm missing Z. You know, I got 1,000 coming in, and my bills are 1,000, and well, I got to eat, and I need gas in my car, and, you know, and then you're going like, oh, my God. And you say, this weekend, we're going to go out with the friends, and then the electricity bills falls in, and the water bill falls in, and it's red letter. It's not an invitation. Red is not good. Yes, it means stop, but it means they're going to stop your electricity, they're going to stop your water. And so now you have a choice. Do I go out with my friends and eat and spend the $30, or do I pay my water bill? If I don't pay my water bill, by Monday I have no water. Oh, they're about to know, and they're about to grow. Amen? And then, but every one of us going to go through that. Every one of you are going to go through that. You too, Flaco. You're going to be at home with Mama forever. You're going to have your own place. And, you know, Flaco's working in the ministry as the head of I don't know if it's janitorial, but he works. Janitor's okay? He goes, I don't care. I'm mopping, sweet. Janitorial, yes, that's right there. Maintenance thing, like his maintenance, but like he can't fix nothing, but still. But he works hard. Even David tells me, he goes, that's one word, how is it? That's one person who works hard. And it's not easy for David to say things like that, Flaco, so I want you to know that. Okay, he said it a different way, that's why I couldn't say it. I can't say you some of those words, but he comes the moment he gets here. But sometimes I catch him. He likes hanging out with the ladies in the office, and I said, "What are you doing, Flaco?" "Nothing." I said, "Get over there, do something." All right, there he goes. But when I call him, he gets it done. Jacob, the same thing. We used to tell Jacob, man, he loves mopping and cleaning those windows, boy. I said, we got more things to do than that. Same thing with him. At 2 o'clock, he wants to mop. I said, not till the end of the day. Because the moment you mop, we're going to walk all over it again, and then you got to mop it again. But then he comes here, and even his mama told me, he goes, he's made a change at home. He's acting differently. He missed one Sunday morning. We're going to leave it at that. God's still working on him, right, my boy? But we love him, and we mess with him. Don't we mess with you, Flacco? Yes, we do. David and me, we love messing with him, and he takes it like a champ, man. He doesn't, right, David? He's just like, whatever, I don't care. I get paid. You know what I'm saying? But the thing about it is this, is that when we have our home, it changes everything. It's like, and sometimes you can't understand it. Sometimes you can't absorb it. But what it is it's a way of God is showing you what his home means to him. The Bible says that a man who does not provide, and I'm not trying to hurt anybody's feelings. It's the word of God. If it hurts your feelings, then do something about it. Hello. But a man who does not provide for his family is worse than an infidel. And an infidel is one that who goes by their emotions, goes by their feelings, goes by how they feel about certain things and how things affect them and how things in this and things like that. But in ministry, it's the same thing. As a pastor of this church, I can't let my emotions affect me. I can't let my feelings affect me. I got to govern this house the way the Word of God says to do it. I can't let you get crazy in the house of God. I can't let you get ridiculous in the house of God. You know what I'm saying? We're not going to have a beauty contest or a bathing suit contest in the front of the church. You know what I'm saying? We're not going to get involved in junk and all kinds of stuff. You know, even though I might win the contest, but still. And that's in my dreams. But home, and then so when we think about home is, this is your place. And then, so same thing about heaven is that we cannot appreciate heaven or even appreciate God's house and the immaculateness of God's house because we're too stubborn and we're too judgmental when it comes to things. You have people that live in mansions. Look at those snotty people. They're rich. They think they're bad. They think they it. You know, you see it all over the news. They should give us their money. That's the way people see heaven. It's my right. I deserve it. If you're my daddy, you should give it to me anyway. Because ain't you love? Doesn't God mean love? And if you love me, God, then you just give it to me. If not, then you're a mean daddy. You're a mean father. There are some kids in Hollywood that have divorced their parents. Believe it or not, they got a lawyer, and they, is that me? They got a lawyer, and they, what do you call that? Well, they, not divorce, but they separate themselves from their dad and mom. What's it called? Emancipation, yeah, there it is. Because now they have their own money and they want to do what they want to do. They're doing that in Hollywood. And now I think two of them are broke. But everything, and I want you to listen, I'm going to be done. Everything you're going through in life is preparing you for heaven. Johnny, every decision we make is in prepare us to enter to heaven. You know what I'm saying, Joe? And so every trial and every tribulation and everything that's taking place is taking place so you can understand what he's preparing you for. Now, he's telling you there's a place there'll be no more tears, no more pain, no more hurt. And we go to Revelation chapter 7, verse 13 and 17. Through 17, we go there. It says, and one of the elders answered, saying to me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which came out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall what? Hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. Leave it right there. Go back. They ain't talking about food. They're not talking about water. Remember the story of the lady at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, and the Lord says, give me something to drink for I thirst. And if you would ask of me of the waters, the living waters, he goes, you will never thirst again. He's talking about his word. He's talking about the understanding of heaven. He's talking about the understanding of the kingdom. He's talking about if you could understand my words and you could receive it, you'll never thirst for any other knowledge than the knowledge you have. You never hunger for anything else because you have it all. To understand what a home is, to understand what a family is, to understand the concept of rules and limitations is, to fall under authority, to fall under the conviction of the Holy Ghost, and to separate yourself from things that would destroy you, because whatever could destroy you could destroy the fabric of your family and could destroy your home, and God cannot allow that to come into heaven. He says, can't you understand that one thing that so easily puts you back, if I allow you here, will put my kingdom back too. And in this house, I cannot allow, God says, anything that's wrong and evil and don't have the understanding or the concept of what it is that means something to you. People in the military that join the military, when they are called to go to war, they understand perfectly well, especially those who already served in war in Iraq and Iran, Afghanistan and Kuwait and Desert Storm and all of these. They understand already why they are there. So that type of battle won't happen in their backyard. They take it to them so they won't bring it to us. He says, I got to stop them here, because if they get to the United States, if they get to our country, then we got to fight this battle here. We saw what it did to France. We saw what it did to Germany. We saw how it destroyed Russia. We saw how it destroyed Europe. We're seeing what's happening with ISIS right now in Europe and all over, how it's destroying the very fabric of their country. We got to stop that from coming here, because if that junk comes here, it will destroy the United States of America. And that means it will affect my family. And then my Smith & Wesson ain't going to do nothing for me when it's 101. See, God understands that perfectly well when it comes to heaven. He can't allow anything that do not understand the concept or get the idea of what heaven is about. It's your home. And you got to protect your home. You got to protect everything that you work for. You got to protect everything that's there. You got to respect it. And you can't allow nothing to come into your heaven on earth. There was a time in my home, I opened it up to every person imagined. My baby girl, my honey, my wife, Nancy, had to endure a lot of things. Me trying to help people. I remember one time, these people I brought in, and they stole a lot of my stuff, and I cried to God. I said, Lord, I don't understand. I'm trying to help them, Lord God. He goes, look, they stole my stuff. And God says, I told you to help them. I said, to help them, but I didn't say to bring you home, because the thief don't know nothing but to steal. Your home is a sanctuary. Your home is supposed to be a house of safety. You protect that home from anything that might cause disaster in your home. That means you protect them from the internet.
That means you protect them from television, you protect them from the radio, and you protect them from anything they're listening to or seeing or being a part of that will affect your house. The order of your house, the authority in your house. And you do it when they're small. And even then, with everything you try, some stuff still gets in. And when you see it, it's not a laughing matter. It's got to get out. And you say, why is that, Pastor? He goes, you know, that's not what it's supposed to be. Well, you ain't supposed to be a friend. You're supposed to be a parent. And child, you ain't supposed to be a friend to your parent. You're supposed to be a son and daughter. And God wants you to understand that there is a chain of command. There is a link that brings everything together. It's called a sovereignty of God. In heaven, there's only one that rules, and that's God. And some people say, well, it sounds like a dictatorship, but then welcome to the dictatorship then. That's what you want to call it. Every time there's rules and things that goes against you, or things that goes against what you believe in, what you want to do, what you want to accomplish, and what you want to have, they're dictators, they're Nazis, they're homophobes, and they're all kinds of phobes, and why? Because we don't agree with you. Well, guess what? You don't have to come to my house. You don't like me? Fine. Then you're not welcome in my home. You want to come and bring a bunch of junk in my house? I can't allow you to do that. Why? I'm not going to allow you to tear my family apart. I'm not going to allow you to rip my children from my arms. I'm not going to allow you to take my husband. I'm not going to allow you to take my wife. Devil, you're not welcome in my house. Only one got excited. You understand what I'm saying? So God wants you to understand your home is supposed to be a guide for you. It's supposed to be an understanding from you. The things that he doesn't allow in his house, you can't allow in yours. But if he just give it to you, you never appreciate it. Heaven is a real place, and it's a wonderful place. And the day we go home to heaven, and we walk through those pearly gates, and we stand before the living God, we're going to understand all of it. Now I know why I went through what I went through. You know what I'm saying, T? I understand why I had to pay such a dear price for the love of my husband and the love of my family. And I understand why the Bible said to submit yourself one to another, for this is right before God. And I understand why I shouldn't have said this to my husband, or I shouldn't have said this to my wife, and why I shouldn't have done this. Why? Because it caused a rip in our family, in our structure, in our home. The one place that's supposed to be safety, the one place where there'll be peace and tranquility, and honor and respect and love. If I allow this in my house, then even my house becomes the world. You can't allow that to happen. One more verse. Go to Colossians 3, 1 through 7. With this, we're going to be done. If ye then be risen with Christ, look what it says this. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Whew. Set your affections on things above, not on things on this earth. For ye are dead. Everybody say, I'm dead. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with him in glory. You see what it's saying? Put your thoughts on things above. Seek things above. Let your affections be things above, not on this earth. Because why? We are dead to this world. Your house is a safe heaven, and everything else outside of your house has no part of your home. In your house, you should be dead to all these things. All these things should be dead from you. Why? Because you have your mind in Christ. He says, He is my life. And when He comes, and He is my life, He's my heartbeat, He's everything that sustains me, that's your home. As you stand to your feet today. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you also appear with Him in glory. My family is my life. Brenda, as much as I love you, I love your family. I don't love my family less. I love them even more. You know what I'm saying, Linda? If something would happen to my baby girls, or my boys, it would devastate me. Linda knows how that feels. But you feel the same thing with your husband and your wife. If you allow anything or anyone to come between your marriage and destroys your marriage, you kill that marriage. You destroy that marriage. You destroy the relationship. You destroy the one thing that matters a lot to God is family. Divorce is not a beautiful thing. It's a horrible thing. Sometimes you have to because your partner just lost their dang mind. And for the sake of your children, for the sake of things, it's just, you have to. Because there's another home besides that one. That's your heart. But see, Linda, if I die to myself and then my wife dies to herself, then who's left is life, and that's God. And if I'm dead to the world, then the world can't affect me. The world cannot influence me. But if my wife is still alive to the world, it's going to influence and it's going to affect her. That's why God said, I can't let you come home like this. You understand? You've got to understand that you mean so much to God, that He loves you so much, that He's not going to let one bad apple ruin the bunch. He's not going to let nothing enter in to take from you that has been given to you by God. He said, I love you so much. As much as I love that person, I got to separate so you can be happy. Sometimes you got to get rid of people in your life. You got to move people, friends, or relations that you have and that is not healthy for your family. Why? Because your kids should be the most important thing to you. Your husband, your wife should be more important than anything else to you, than anything or anybody else. You cannot allow just anything to come to your house. Heaven. Y'all cannot allow, God cannot allow just anything to come to heaven. He is not going to let anything break down that house. Because you are important to God. And everything there is important to God. Because everything that was created there was created for you. Even the flowers, and the lilies, and the roses, and the daisies, and all everything that's in heaven, everything you see, was for your enjoyment. And nothing's going to come in there and destroy that. And God doesn't want to see you cry anymore. He don't want to see you hurt anymore. So He's going to make sure that when you go to heaven, it's a safe haven. It's a safe place. It's a strong tower. It takes me away from everything that's bad. He's not going to allow you, Flaco, to get hurt anymore. He saw you hurt way too long. He's daddy. He's dad. He's your father. He's not going to allow you to get hurt no more. He says, enough is enough. They're home now. You got to get through me to get through them. And no one's getting through the Father. I can tell you that right now. So when you're there, he'll wipe every tear. You never cry again. Why? Because there's nothing but joy. People said who have died and gone to heaven or seen heaven, they said it's a joy they cannot explain. It's overwhelming, an overwhelming peace. It's like, oh my God, for the first time in your life, you have no emotions, no fear, no doubt, no nothing. You're home. Every time I go home and I open the door to my front house and I walk in, and I look, always walk in my front door and I look all over to the house and I says, I'm responsible from the inner of that door to the inside of this house. Outside these walls is not my responsibility, but I am responsible here as head of the house. And I have to make sure. My wife is the same way. Make sure that I keep everything out so my kids could sleep well at night. So my babies could rest at night. So they can sit there and not worry about nothing because they know that daddy has everything under control. Dad's got their back. And that, my friend, is heaven. That's our Father in heaven. We could be there. We're going to go to heaven one day. We're going to stand before God. We're going to be with God. And we know that we are never going to hurt again. No devil and no demon is going to come and mess with us no more. Perfect peace. Perfect joy. And I want to see all my kids there with me. I'd love to see every one of you there too. Talk about heaven. So that's why he can't just bring you home. That's why he can't say, just come on. Because you got to understand, Jacob, what is it to be a dad? Valerie, what is it to be a mom? What is it to be a mother, a daughter, a son? To understand the heart of God, Reggie. As you work with these boys and you hurt with these boys and you cry with these boys and you pray with these boys, and because that's what God does every day. He has you there to represent his heart and represent his purpose and represent his kingdom. Show these boys my love. But let them know that I can't let them come in this way. They got to change. They got to give their heart to me. They got to confess with their mouth that Jesus is Lord. They got to understand that the family is bigger than just one person and one selfish reasons. It's about everybody. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for sending your son to die so we can live. Thank you for taking my place when I should have been hanging on that cross. You died and you hung the cross in my stead. But as a dad and as a husband, I don't want nothing to happen to my family. And I'll do everything I can to assure that that won't happen. But sometimes, Father God, we do all we can do and things still go bad. But we're still on this earth. We're still living in this world. But I just know that one day when we go home to heaven, that's not my job no more. That's not my responsibility no more. I don't have to worry about those things no more. Why? Because I'm under you. I'm under new government. I'm under new management, praise God. And my job is just to enjoy life eternal. To worship God, to praise God, and to live there in heaven forever and ever, eternity. And never again will I know pain. Never again will I know hurt. And never again will I know lost. And never again will I see my baby cry. And never again I see my son cry. And never again, Lord God, I'll feel the hurt and the pains and the anguish and the anger that comes with living in this world. Never again will I experience disaster. Because I'll be home. I'll be home where the builder and maker is God. Hallelujah. I'll be home, Lord God, where nobody could go in to hurt me. No one could go in to cause me harm. No one come in, Lord, to do anything treacherous. I'll be home. I'll be home. I'll be home. Where my daddy will be there. When I want to embrace him, I want to be safe. I'll be home. And I'll say, I understand. I understand the concept of home. The Bible tells us that in my Father's house there are many mansions. And if it wasn't so, I wouldn't tell you that I go to my Father's house. In John 14, 2 and 4. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know. He's going to be over there. Pastor Rod Parsley one time put it this way. In one of his sermons in summer camp at World Harvest Church in Columbus, Ohio, he said, if I got to go through the swamp, and when I get to the gate, it's just a cardboard box with leather hinges attached to it. But if my Jesus is on the other side, that's where I want to be. It's not about the mansions. It's not about the golden streets. It's not about the rivers and the oceans made like glass. It's not about the 12 floors of the New Jerusalem and everyone made with some precious stone. It's about coming home, where we belong, where we were snatched away because of sin, when we were brought down because of sin. And sin will never be able to hold us back. It's about going home. And if going home, all I do is sleep on the couch, I'll be happy to do so. Because I'm home. Amen? Put your hands together and give God some praise.